Hello everyone and welcome to 3 days national webinar on trends and challenges in chemistry. In short, TCC 2021 organized by Department of Chemistry of Anekant Education Societies, Tulsaram Chaturchand College of Arts, Science and Commerce, Baramati Autonomous, in association with Rashtriya Uchchatar Shiksha Abhiyan, RUSA. Good morning to all of you. First, let me introduce myself. I am Dr. Yogesh Nana Indulkar, Assistant Professor and the coordinator of this webinar. Until late in the 20th century, the primary resource of discovering new information was the local public library, which was a place for classes and seminars as much as a repository of books. However, in the 21st century, we rely on the internet for the latest up-to-date information, and instead of public talk, we attend online webinars, an activity that many people enjoy. Webinars are not only an excellent way to learn new things, but also require you to consider the subject from someone else's perspective and follow their line of logic. Especially with the unpredicted pandemic, most events have been replaced with webinars and virtual conferences. Therefore, we organize this webinar. The goal of this webinar is to focus on discussion and presentation of the current research and applications of chemical science. Today, on behalf of the organizing committee, I welcome you all to this event, TCC 2021. This session is inauguration session of the webinar. Therefore, let me introduce first our college and department. Tulsaram Chaturchand College of Arts, Science and Commerce, Baramati, District Pune, is one of the leading and prestigious college in Maharashtra, established in 1962 with motto We for Students. The college has full-fledged UG courses in Arts, Science and Commerce along with PG courses almost in all subjects of different stream, as well as PhD research centers. Besides traditional courses, college has developed and introduced new need-based, value-added, skill-based and career-oriented courses. The college has been re-accredited for the third cycle with A+ grade, CGPA 3.55 by NAC Bangalore in 2017. It has been awarded the status of College with Potential for Excellence by UGC and has been selected for Star College Scheme by DBT. Also, DST Feast Scheme by DST New Delhi. The college has received several awards from Savitribai Phule Pune University, Pune, including Best College Award, Best Principal Award, Best Student Welfare Officer Award, Best NSS Coordinator Award, Best NSS Unit Award, Best NSS Volunteer Award. By observing the continuous increasing plot of college, UGC has awarded the autonomous status. Recently, college has got ranking number 58 in national ranking. About department, Department of Chemistry is one of the oldest and largest department in the college, offer bachelor degree in chemistry, and we have 3 master's degree, MSc in inorganic chemistry, MSc in organic chemistry, and MSc in analytical chemistry. So our department, perhaps our college, is the only college where the 3 post-graduation degrees in chemistry offers in the rural area affiliated to Savitribai Phule Pune University, Pune. Department has competent and committed teaching staff dedicated and helpful administrative staff, and most important, state-of-the-art infrastructure. Department continuously organizes various activities for the benefits of the students. This activity is one of them. Now we inaugurate this webinar with showing college documentary.
With a vision of providing quality education to students of various strata of the society, the founding stone of Tuljaram Chaturchand College Baramati were kept in the year 1962. The college has been formed with the efforts of numerous people.
Our society is a religious minority institute, and we thrive well with the preamble of Siddhir Nikatan, means knowledge from all the dimensions.
She put his with that of the line. As Zozo Para Azar with that of Persel, he called Ramin Mahatma Sagra Mutu Kalikum as Gandhazar.
The college is affiliated to Savitribai Phule Pune University.
We are willing to empower the youth to skill and the career oriented educational and vocational programs so that he will be full placed for grabbing the opportunities for his career.
The college has well qualified team of experienced teaching staff who are always ready to help, assist, guide and motivate the students. Regular meetings are conducted to keep a track of the development of the students and to plan new activities for their growth. Providing various streams of education under one roof makes Tuljaram Chaturchand College a renowned academic institution. With such numerous courses being provided in the college, the administrative department continuously and promptly maintains a smooth flow of activities in a well-managed manner. The college focuses on imparting career-oriented quality education at par with global standard. The senior college offers three streams: arts, commerce, and science. The college offers 22 different courses for graduation as well as post-graduation in various departments like geography department, psychology department, yoga department, bachelor of vocation program of UGC in two disciplines, food processing and psychology department, yoga department, bachelor of vocation program of UGC in two disciplines, food processing and post-harvest technology and journalism and mass communication. The college has well-equipped laboratories where students under the guidance of their professors learn and conduct various experiments. The electronics department in the research arena. The botany department had set up their own botanical garden, well-equipped biology labs. IT department has well-equipped computer lab with Wi-Fi internet facility where students can develop their computer science skills. The classrooms are well designed
with projection facilities, and the students are encouraged to have a better understanding of their subject with friendly interaction with the teachers. The college campus is built with a central library which has a huge setup of numerous books of various streams. Student can access the library and read on various subjects to gain an in-detail knowledge. There is a reading hall adjoined to the library where the students can peacefully study and take note on various topics of their interest. If a student wants to get some additional information on this subject, TC College also provides an internet cafe. The college has a huge auditorium, Jivraj Sabhagraha, with all the modern facilities, where around the year numerous events and functions are conducted for cultural educational growth of the students. Along with academics, the college has given equal importance to physical development of the student by providing innumerable sports activities like volleyball for boys and girls, kabaddi, basketball, boxing for boys and girls. The college has trained and developed some great sports persons who have won remarkable awards on various national and international platforms. The college provides NCC training, where the cadets are given basic military training in small arms and parades. The cadets are well trained and given preference over normal candidates during selections. The officers provide good training and discipline education to the students. The NSS activities are conducted by the students, like street plays, to bring awareness in the society. Plantation, construction of buns, and many others. And for these activities, the college has received various recognition and awards for their contribution towards society. Since 41 years, the college has been organizing a Moropanth elocution and debating competition every year, which is a state-level competition. The college publishes an annual magazine called Anekan to motivate the creative skills of our students by providing a platform where they can publish their poems, articles, and their opinions.
Yes, so city prevailed Astana. आम्ही एम बी कॉलेजचे नवीन बिल्डिंग मध्ये अनेकांत इंग्लिश मिडियम स्कूल म्हणून नवीन बिल्डिंग बांधून त्या ठिकाणी सुरुवात केली. या ग्रामीण भागामध्ये हे कॉलेज सुरू होत असताना इथल्या मुलींची निश्चितपणे एक चांगल्यापैकी व्यवस्था झाली आढळून येईल. कारण सहसा मुली बाहेरगावी पाठवायला पालक तयार नसतात, पण हे कॉलेज सुरू झाल्यामुळे त्या मुलींना चांगले शिक्षणाचं दारुण उपलब्ध करून देण्यासारखं होईल.
स्त्रियांच्या आरोग्यावर शिबिर आयोजित केली जातात.
College also fulfills its social responsibility by conducting various events of awareness and confidence building in women. And to build a healthy environment, it also conducts the activity of plantation. The institute has also received various government funds for its welfare and further development.
Our institute is NAC re-accredited with a B grade. Also, we have undergone ISO certification 9001. The college has received the funding for DST PhD program. The institute is recipient of Star College status from DBT.
The college has also got various funds like College with Potential for Excellence and has won many recognition and awards in various fields.
We are seeking that a student should be at the excellence at par, not only academics, but in other activities. sports, competitive career, as well as the vocational skills.
The teaching department over here is very much friendly. We have the library, which includes books from all the schools.
We have achieved many prizes of national and state level.
The college has boosted our confidence.
The computer science department of a college has well-equipped laboratory.
The teaching staff here is good at transforming student attitude and creating better individuals.
The days are not far ahead that this institute will be a benchmark, not only in Maharashtra or India, but in the global scenario.
This is the journey of Tuljaram Chaturchand College, where it has enriched and nurtured hidden talent of students from various strata of the society and transformed them into confident and responsible citizens to excel in all walks of life.
On behalf of the organizing committee and my own behalf, I welcome you again, all of you, to this event, TCC 2021. This webinar consists of daily two sessions, 10 to 11:15 and 11:15 to 12:30 on 6th, 7th and 8th February 2021, with total 6 talks of different eminent speakers from industrial and research arena. More than 300 participants from different states of India, from different categories like PG students, research scholar, and teachers are registered in this event. Now I request our principal, Dr. Chandrasekhar V. Murumkar, convener of this webinar, to address participants of this event, National Webinar on Trends and Challenges in Chemistry.
Good morning. I am very much happy that Department of Chemistry of Anikant Education Society's Tuljaram Chaturchand College is organizing a 3-day national webinar on the topic Trends and Challenges in Chemistry. Well, I am very much happy that each and everyone in India and abroad, they are waiting to things get opened up. The opportunities are there and we are seeking that these opportunities are going to give us the new boost to come over and make a comeback in the new era of post-COVID. Dear friends, I must congratulate the head of the Department of Chemistry and the organizing secretary, Professor Sanjay Kale, the coordinator of this national webinar, Dr. Yogesh Indulkar, and their team for selecting the wonderful subjects from the chemistry, and also they have collected a galaxy of scientists and professionals all over India. To name few, Dr. Nilesh Sringadi from Harman Fellowcap, Dr. Sharad Lande from Reliance Industries, Dr. Ajay Chhatre from United Phosphorus, Dr. Sanjay Dabade from Wukaj, Dr. Sudhir Arbus from CIMET, and Dr. Balchandra Kakde from SRN Research Institute, Chennai, to name few. Dear friends, the 21st century is changing miraculously. It is changing in a metaphoric way. And this is possible because all the changes which are taking place in industry. Today, the industry has changed its total clothes and the new wave of chemistry has come up. Obviously, one has to rely totally on nuclear chemistry, on organic chemistry, polymer chemistry, and obviously the chemicals which are related with agriculture. I'm very much sure that you are aware that agro-business is one of the giant business in coming days. Along with that, there's another business which is associated with agriculture, and that is food production and food processing. I do know that food technology is a new emerging trend which is having a transaction of more than almost 600 crores of dollars every year. And that's definitely for each and everyone, there's an opportunity to work here. Dear friends, right from the basics from chemistry, we have come to an age where the chemistry has changed its total phenomena, and now we are entering into the field of nanotechnology. This particular world of nanotechnology is changing the face of 21st century, and also it is solving several problems we faced in 20th century. To name few, the pollution, the e-waste and related aspects which were the hindrance for the development in 20th century. Now we are finding that there are several solutions which are coming up in new days. Obviously, the galaxy of resource persons who are addressing you through this national webinar, I'll be very much happy that interaction with these eminent scientists and personalities definitely is going to give you the new approach, new way, and new methodology and new technology to cope with in coming days. Dear friends, that each and every participant must be happy that he is going to see, interact, and collaborate with these eminent personalities through this national webinar. And I do know that ultimately, the self-reliance is the theme which has been accepted by Honorable Prime Minister Narendra Modi. And this self-reliance comes only through not only the academics, but it comes from the professionalism and comes from the development. And yes, these young buddies who are participating today, they are knowing that their future is well. Dear friends, not only India, the world is waiting for you. You have to come forward and shape the world as per you wish. But for this purpose, you have to believe in what was known to us, and you have to believe your dreams, what are supposed to be the future for the next generation. Well, this national seminar on trends and challenges in chemistry will definitely give you a new boost in coming days, and I know that you will sustain through this in a more professional way. I wish you all a great success at the end. Thank you. Have a great time.
Thank you, sir, for your valuable words. I would like to take this opportunity to thank our Anekant Education Societies and member of this society for supporting, helping and encouraging to organize such type of events for students and faculties. Also, I grateful to Principal Dr. Chandrasekhar Murumkar for providing facility, taking initiative to organize this webinar and addressing us with few informative words. I believe that by participating in this webinar, we are in the right place and the right time. I ensure the webinar will be profitable and the coming 3 days will be enjoyable and fruitful for every one of you. Please note, ask your question on chat box or on Telegram group or on personal email of the resource person. Our question and answer team is working on it and will discuss with resource person. You will get solution of few questions on the chat box or on Telegram group or on personal email. Feedback link will be provided to you on Monday, 8th February 2021 at 1 p.m. and available to you up to 8 p.m. of the same day. For getting the participation certificate, registration, attendance and filling the feedback form is mandatory. Now come to the main part of this webinar. I request Professor Sri Krishna T. Salunke, Associate Professor, Chemistry, to introduce our today's first resource person and start this session. Thank you very much.
I am here to introduce the dynamic person, Dr. Sharad Lande. Did his PhD in chemistry from ICT, Mumbai, with Professor G.D. Yadav. He was recipient of Ambuja's Cement Best PhD Thesis Awards, ICT, Mumbai. He did his postdoctorate research at Center for Catalysis Research and Innovation, University of Ottawa, Canada, and worked on PhD-supported catalyst for carbonylation reactions and heterogeneous catalyst system for dimethyl carbonate systems for 2 years. He has joined Reliance R&D Center in the year of 2007 and currently working as Assistant Vice President and have more than 18 years of research experience in the field of heterogeneous catalysis for hydrocarbon conversion. At REEL, he is involved in commercialization of layered alumina catalyst for dehydrogenation of N-paraffin, redox catalyst for nitrogen purification at PET, Hazaria commercialization of ZEAL feed at lab, PMD. He is also working on development of novel catalyst for VOCs removed from petrochemical and refinery streams, adsorptive purification of various streams and root cause of ethylene oxide catalyst. He has 30 international publications and 25 patent field, 15 patents granted in India, US and other countries. He was a co-guide for 4 M.Tech and 1 PhD thesis project on industrial catalysis and won several technical excellence awards in Reliance. He is also reviewer of various peer-reviewed synthetic journals as Catalyst Communication, Journal of Porous Materials, Chemical Engineering Journal, International Journal of Chemical Research Engineering, Chemical Product and Processes Modeling, Journal of Chemical and Engineering Data, Clean, Soil, Air, Water and Catalysis in Green Chemistry and Engineering. So, I request to Dr. Sharad Lande, please.
Good morning to all of you. And first, I would like to thank all the organizing committee of this seminar, and especially Professor Indulkar, Dr. Hanuman Guru, and the other team member who has taken effort to organize such type of seminar under this COVID situation. And it will be great experience for the student and faculty member who can learn from this interactive seminar, and which can use few of the examples in their ongoing research. So basically today I am going to talk on catalysis, basically industrial catalysis. I am an industry person and I am working in the industry, influence industry in R&D. So mostly our priorities are to scale up and commercialize the catalysis process. But I will take you how, what is this industrial catalysis, how is it important, and what are the challenges basically for the researcher who want to work in this area and who has the great future if they do the continuous research in this area. Okay. So this is a disclaimer, whatever I am talking, this is my views, there is no view from the Reliance. So whatever the my experience that I am sharing with the background of our R&D. So today I will cover in my outline presentation what is the industrial catalysis, what is the global catalyst requirement, because why the catalyst is important for the society, how it is useful in the process to make various chemicals which are using in our day-to-day life. And then how this catalyst can be prepared industrially and characterization. These are instruments, spectroscopy technique, which we are studying in BSc and MSc level. And how much it is important to characterize any catalyst and how much it contribute to know the catalyst life and catalyst processes. That is very important. And then I will cover some of the major petrochemical processes where we are making the chemicals and where the role of the catalyst is very critical. And then some of the strategic analysis where we are going as a world in terms of chemicals, petrochemicals, or new energy. That also I will cover briefly. And what are the future opportunities for the scientists, researcher, faculties who are working, doing the research in this area. So if you see, Reliance is making many products in different areas. And the major products are basically LPG. We are making liquefied petroleum gas, which is the application in domestic and industrial fuel. Propylene, we are making ethylene propylene, which is a feedstock for polypropylene, polyethylene, which we are seeing different polymer grade chemicals. The naphtha is basically feedstock for chemicals. Gasoline, we are making transport fuel for your day-to-day vehicles. And again, we are making jet aviation turbine fuel, aviation fuel, high-speed diesel. And then sulfur, we are generating more than 1 million metric ton of the sulfur from the processes. So that also is going for fertilizer and pharmaceutical application. And finally, petroleum coke also we are getting from the crude oil. So that also used for a fuel for power plant and cement plant. So basically, Reliance is the largest producer of petrochemicals in the country and amongst the top 10 in the world. So they have a big plant at various sites in the Reliance Jamnagar, Dahej, Hajira, and in Maharashtra also, Nagothane. If you see, what will the chemical have shown, apart from that also, estimates are that 90% of all the chemicals produced involve catalysts at some stages in the process of their manufacturing. So you can understand the chemicals we are seeing as a society application. So role of the catalyst is very important. Almost 90% product needs a catalyst at certain level. So basically, what is a catalyst? People say catalyst, catalysis. Basically, the catalysis term was coined by Berzelius in 1835. What he concluded that besides affinity, so new force is operative, and that force within the molecule is a catalytic force. So now coming to the major product, these are maybe the slide will be not visible for you due to the integration of the slide, but there in these slides, just I want to show that whole integration, how the Reliance is doing making the different product. In all the stages, every stage catalyst is important. If you start from the chlorine-alkali plant, where we are making the chlorine and we have the electrolysis process where we are generating the chlorine for various processes. Then polyester, we are making the PET, what a polyester we are seeing, purified terephthalic acid, yarn, different fabrics. Then petrochemicals, we are making all the chemicals majorly, polypropylene, PVC pipe, VCM raw material, again EVA, ethyl oxide, that is an important chemical Reliance is making, then MEG. Then if you go to refining, LPG gas, gasoline, ATF jet fuel, naphtha, diesel, sulfur, propane, fuel oil. This is integration. Once we get the oil and gas, natural gas as well as crude oil, then how you mix a different product? That is one example of that. So this is the chain of the molecule we are making, and we are mostly importing to outside, and we are using India for various products. So if you see all pharmaceutical, fine chemical, specialty chemical, the raw material Reliance is making, that is the benzene, ethylene. So benzene molecule is important to make any organic molecules. You can see. So many molecules can make from benzene, xylene. Xylene also is raw material. So in all the chemicals, if you see major product, catalysts play a major role to produce each and every stage. Now if you see the historical development, how these industrial catalysts has evolved basically, when it has started. So if you see in 1875, during the Second World War, there was a requirement in Germany of H2SO4, because H2SO4 has wide applications in explosive, to make the explosive material, and then cleaning applications. So H2SO4 was the important parameter in that area. So in 1875, H2SO4 was making by the lead chamber process by using platinum-based catalyst. Okay, that was the first catalytic process evolved. So you can see here, platinum SO2 plus SO3 gas. The SO2 gas, sulfur was there, we had to convert SO3 and then you had to dissolve in water. So H2SO4 was the first product which can make in 1875. Then urination was there. Formaldehyde is made from ethanol. Then in 1900, nitric acid is made, which you can say the explosive TNT we can make from nitration reaction. Then followed by urolation was there in 1925. We make malic anhydride, fat salt oil. Then FCC, Fischer Tropsch, has come to make different chemicals which are useful for our society. Then going back 1950, reforming has come, where now we are seeing all this polyester, benzene, toluene, xylene. Whatever we are wearing the cloth polyester, That is a major evolution has happened. Then followed by polymers, different polymers we are using as various applications. If you see tires or pharmaceutical, fine chemicals. So that also evolution has happened in 1950. But the major evolution has happened in autocatalyst in 1975. All the cars, whatever right now we are seeing, diesel car, in that car, catalytic converter is there. So that converter is basically platinum-based catalyst is there. Platinum, palladium, rhodium. It is a three-way catalytic converter. What that catalyst is doing, that is converting all your CO to CO2 and SOx and NOx. So basically it is reducing the pollution. CO is harmful to atmosphere and human being. So the role of the catalyst is very important. So if you see all the cars right now, not electric car I am seeing, whatever the car right now we are using, every car has a catalytic converter. That was a revolution has happened in the catalysis. Then apart from that, now a lot of things are happening in biodiesel, ethylene glycol, biopharmaceutical, we are making with the help of catalyst. So now the world is basically bio world, biochemicals. There are many chemicals we can make with the help of catalyst. So in biodiesel also glycerol is a side product. So glycerol we can make a lot of chemical, lignin we can make a lot of chemicals. So there also role of catalyst is very important. So catalyst today is now in this special and strategic. So if you see, this is a person, Dr. Gerhard. In 2007, he got a Nobel Prize in chemistry for determining the molecular mechanism of catalytic oxidation of carbon monoxide or platinum catalyst, like catalytic converter. So that was a game changer in catalytic converter. So this person has studied how this reaction happens when the CO react with oxygen, with the catalyst, how it converts under the temperature and pressure condition. So for that, he got a Nobel Prize for his pioneer work. Now coming to noble metal magic. Basically, if you see in catalysis, if you are aware or maybe if you are not aware also, there are many metals which use as a catalyst. But out of that, noble metals basically, if you see the periodic table, platinum, palladium, silver, all are noble metals. And noble metals are basically widely used as a catalyst in a lot of chemicals. Why basically noble metals are used as a catalyst? Because they can change their oxygen state. They have fecund d-orbital. And due to their variable oxidation state, they can form different bonds and break the bonds, which can make different molecules. So that is when they are widely used in the chemical industry. But if you see one class of noble metal, silver, platinum, palladium. So I am giving simple example, which can understood to BSc or MSc student also. If I take ethylene and oxygen, I take silver-based catalyst, silver catalyst, if I take silver metal, so I will get ethylene oxide. Okay. Same ethylene and oxygen, if I take platinum-based catalyst, it will combust. It will get CO2 and water. That is a byproduct. Okay. But same catalyst, same molecule, if I take palladium, so I will get acetaldehyde. So you can see the magic of this chemistry. That is the reason people are saying, say this noble metal are magic metal. Because we can do a lot of chemistry with this noble metal basically. So why these metals are active for the catalysis? So for catalysis or any chemical reaction, what is required? You require two reactant or one reactant, gas, solid or liquid. And it has to be converted into product. So this chemistry is based on this principle, Savitzer principle. So when you are reactant like ethylene, react with silver or platinum. So the interaction between ethylene and silver, it should be optimum. It should not be too strong. If it is too strong, then you will get CO2, right? Because the molecule will not dissolve, product molecule will not dissolve from the catalyst surface. So it should be dissolved and it should be from the product. If it is too weak, then your reaction rate will be very slow. You will not get any product. So it should be optimum. So when the ethylene or any molecule react with your silver, platinum, palladium, there is an interaction between your molecule and catalyst, and that interaction is optimum. That is the real reason this metal behaves different chemistry. If I take platinum, the interaction is very strong of ethylene with platinum. So it will get CO2 and water. So it said that interaction between the catalyst and the substrate should be just right, neither too strong, neither too weak, because the optimum behavior is the compromise between the rate and strength of the chemisorption. Now, the catalytic activity basically, catalytic activity also is based on this interaction. So now, hope you understand the noble metal magic chemistry of the different metals towards the catalysis. Now, if you see the market, why these metals are noble or precious? Why we say precious? So these are the basically noble metal precious catalyst: platinum, palladium, ruthenium, rhodium, iridium, gold, silver, others. Market, if you see, around 20 billion market is there by 2022. And mostly these precious metal are find application in automotive, catalytic converter refining, hydrocarbon, petrochemical, pharmaceutical, electronic also, and mining others. So these are used for different chemistries, and platinum metal out of that is widely used. If you see, the market of platinum is very, very high, very big, 35%. So around 200 ton of the platinum is widely used in the industry worldwide every year. Now coming to the key industrial segment, what are the segments basically where these catalysts are basically used? So already I have shown in one of the slides. So petrochemical, chemicals, polymers, environmental also, like to reduce the pollution, to reduce the VOC, to reduce the wastewater treatment, which is generated from various industries. Then refining, refining to make the different molecules, petrol, diesel, gasolines, and biofuels. Now we are talking a lot of things on biofuels, convert of waste, whatever the waste algae is there, waste greenfield is there, waste biomass is there. There also the role of catalyst is very important. So that industry segment also is covered here. Now, overall, if you see, overall globally, so catalyst definitely are workforce of chemical transformation in any industry. Will not leave any industry. And approximately 85 to 90% of product of chemical industries are made of catalytic process. And if you see, production of transportation fuel, that is the biggest use of catalysis to make the fuel. So around 700 oil refineries are there in worldwide world to meet our demand of energy. Apart from that, production of bulk and fine chemicals in all branches. And prevention of pollution. Basically, there are a lot of issues due to pollution. After this Paris Agreement in 2015, most of the countries now are very careful about the pollution. The government also is very stringent now to formation of waste and to reduce the waste and to work on the pollution control, CO2 generation basically. And then they want end-to-end solution. So catalyst can give an end-to-end solution for the VOC generation or pollution reduction. So ultimately, catalyst offer an alternative energetically favorable mechanism and enable process which can be carried out in feasible conditions. This is a simple example. If you can see a reactant, this is a product. So if you don't use the catalyst, you need more energy. And if you use the catalyst, then your energy is reducing, your time is reducing, your temperature is reducing, your cost is reducing, your process is more economical at lower temperature, your with this VOC reduction, waste generation will be lower. So role of the catalyst is basically to address all this issue. This is basically helpful for green chemistry, the process we can make green. Now, driving force. Why we should know about catalysis? Why we should work in the catalysis? If there is no driving force, we will not know, right? For our feeding, we are eating for our health, right? To get energy for our body. So write that if anybody is working in catalysis globally, what is the market for that? What I will learn from this market? So if you see in 2017, 2020 and 2023, so how the global market is going? Globally, if you see, $31 billion market is there for catalysis and is rise to $40 billion. And now most of the applications are coming syngas, derivative, coal to chemicals. People are working on the advanced fuel to reduce the cost. So their syngas, oxidation, all the process will be very critical. And you see in this table, we have given the distribution of refining, petrochemical, polymer, fine chemical, how the trend is increasing. So basically environmental, fine chemicals, so it is a change, 3 to 4% change. So those who are working, we should build the capability in this area to address these issues. Now coming to the catalyst, what are the material that can be used as a catalyst? Now we have learned that catalyst is a very important area for the society, and it is a long-term for sustainability. We should know what are the material that can be used as a catalyst. Catalyst basically solid acid catalyst or liquid catalyst, but here I'm focusing on heterogeneous catalysis. So what are the solid material which is available that can be used as a catalyst, we can regenerate as a catalyst. So what are the properties of the catalyst that can be recycled, regenerate? So some of the catalyst we can regenerate. So if you see any material, any inorganic material, alumina silica, which is divided in three parts, microporous, mesoporous and macroporous. It is a mixture of that. It is based on the pore size of the material. Means it should have the pores to enter in the molecule for the reaction. So if any molecule interact with the catalyst, so it will interact with the pores, it will go inside the pore, it will react and it will come out. So like that, all the catalysts are divided in microporous, which has a porosity less than 2 nanometer, 4 nanometer, mesoporous, 2 to 50 nanometer, macropores more than 50 nanometers. So based on that, the catalytic material are designed and then we develop the application. So one of them is alumina. Alumina is inexpensive, very not expensive material. Availability is very high. Surface area of alumina is around 400 maximum we can go. Acidity neutral, it is available in acidic. So in some of the application where we require alumina, we can make the catalyst from alumina. We can put palladium and we can use as a heterogeneous catalyst. And that we can explore. Second part is silica also can be used in large quantity available, which has high surface area. Surface area is required to do the chemistry on the surface. And chivalrite is one class, alumina silicate, shapes selective catalyst, where you can make the selective molecule. Like simple example, I will give. But there are two molecules, paraxylene and metaxylene. If you have the control pore size, only paraxylene will pass through to your pores. So in that case, you will get the selectively paraxylene. And if you want metaxylene, then you have to do a safe selective study and you have to make the pores like that. So this is a porous solid basically. You can see the pores. This is a pore structure. Pore structure may be cylindrical, spherical, distributed pores are there. Apart from that, there are other materials who can be used as a catalyst, supported carbon, titania, zirconia, magnesia, that also can be used as a catalyst. But depend on again application and then material property. So inorganic materials basically are used widely as a catalyst, support catalyst, support adsorbent in petrochemical refinery and fine chemical processes. So this is all about the catalytic material, what type of the material can be used as a catalyst. Now going to the industrial catalyst design, if somebody wants to make the catalyst, what are the properties basically he should know and he should understand. If you want to make the first small scale catalyst, then scale up of the catalyst. So for any industrial catalyst design, these are the important parameters like catalytic preparation activity, selectivity, stability, mechanical properties, strength, attrition loss, bulk density, chemical properties, surface area porosity that I have shown, and surface composition. And if you see, these are the catalysts. Catalyst looks like different shapes, depend on application. It should be granular, cylindrical, pellets, thorn bodies, safe shapes, cylindrical. These are modular type of things which can be used as a in catalyst as a catalytic converter. So the shapes are basically based on the application where you need higher gas flow speeds and strength. So that shape is used as per the application. So catalyst design basically is optimized condition of interdependent mechanical, chemical, physical and catalytic property. So that properties are important. I am just giving the surface view to understand basically what are the properties required, because it is very difficult to cover whole thing is in 1 hour time. Now coming to catalyst preparation, how the catalyst can be prepared. Once we got the, now there are alumina, silica, these are the support material, heterogeneous catalyst I have to prepare. And I know I have the platinum palladium solution. So you have to take this, this is a very crucial step because your metal should be distributed all over on the surface. It should be available for the reaction. So precursor, you have to take precursor here, platinum or palladium or silver solution. Then porous oxide, you have to take alumina, silica, you have to mix properly, you have to spray, dry. Whatever the organic material there, you have to decompose, you have to do the thermal treatment, and then you have to oxidize platinum, palladium in the reduced state also after calcination, because it will be in oxide form. Apart from that, there are precipitation techniques also which are used to make the geolite or mix oxide catalyst. And in commercial scale, catalyst we can make like that. These are different spray headers, you can say, we can integrate the solution. These are your catalyst. You have to rotate the drums, but there are a lot of challenges in that. So major challenges is a scale-up and manufacturing of laboratory-developed catalyst. Means if you prepare a catalyst on 10 gram and if you make 1 kg, so it will need a lot of efforts and a lot of chemistry engineering part is involved in that. So these are the methods generally used for catalyst. And apart from that, now people are talking atomic layer deposition. So there you have to make the thin layer of your different metal like zinc, alumina, platinum, palladium. So what will help? It will help produce the coke formation basically. So people are coming with that technique also apart from this normal tool technique. But these are the conventional technique which can use for the catalyst preparation. But in specific technique, where you have to control the particle size of the metal, then this atomic layer deposition technique is very useful. Now, why the catalyst character? Once you make the catalyst, second part, I have to why the catalyst character is important. Like anything, suitability. If you make any new material or any product, like you in the labs also, if you synthesize any product, what you will do? You will do is NMR, a melting point, FTR, because you want to ensure that whatever the molecule I have prepared, that molecule is right molecule. It is not impurity. So in catalyst also, when you prepare the catalyst, the catalyst characterization is very important. Whatever the catalyst I have prepared, that is right catalyst or wrong catalyst, I have to do the any changes in that catalyst, because the process is like that. If you see A and B are reactant product, this is your catalyst. A and B reactant will interact on the catalyst surface. It will form the bonding, a different intermediate. The reaction will happen on this catalyst. It will convert to product. Then the product will form on the catalyst. And after that, next stage, the product will lose the catalyst surface. And again, the catalyst will be available for the next recycle. So that is the whole dynamics of the catalysis. And then the reaction coordinate and potential energy. It will reduce the potential energy, if you see. So to see the effectivity of the catalyst, the characteristic of heterogeneous catalyst is a continuous measure of those physical, chemical properties. That is, which is responsible for your performance. That is very important. And for that, we have to understand the chemistry of that catalysis and the distribution of the metal, acidity, internal structure of the solid, strength of the material. That is very important during the catalysis reaction. So if you see, these are the great people you all of know who are doing the science in maybe chemistry or physics. So these are people has done a lot of work and has contributed for our science and development, and they have white. They have given a lot of contribution for development of catalysis also. So if you start, Sir Isaac Newton, in 1642 and 1726, he has developed the word spectrum to describe the rainbow of the colors. You all have known the prism color. Then by Joseph, who has discovered the dark absorption spectrum in the spectrum. And Albert Einstein, who has developed the photoelectric effect, that is based on our XPS or any analytical technique. And then Kai Sivan has taken this approach and he has developed the XPS, X-ray photoelectron spectroscopy, for characterization of the electron, emitted electron, and the metal bonding, as well as metal state, oxygen state of the metal. Dr. Isaac basically has developed all the titration, whatever the acid titration today we are doing for measurement, acidity and basicity, that a lot of effort has been put by Dr. Isaac. Then our own Dr. C.V. Raman, Raman effect, everybody knows we are using this Raman effect for characterization of many material, like Raman spectroscopy, that we are using the Raman waves. And then Satyendra Bose, who has worked for the quantum mechanics, that is also a good contribution for the development of electronic spectrum. So whole the spectrum, basically, if you see all the rays, gamma, X-ray, UV, visible, infrared, microwave, that has been bombarded on catalyst, it will give some information. So all the techniques are useful to understand the catalyst and to improve the catalyst and to make the new catalyst, innovation, I will say. So all these big people has developed a lot of chemistry, and today, whatever the characterization we are seeing due to their contribution. So now if you see the same thing what I told, reactant, catalyst, product. So all these techniques, X-ray will give XRD, which will give the phase analysis, which is what is the phase of alpha, beta, gamma, phase of the catalyst. If you give IR, it will give the functionality of the catalyst. If you see electron spectroscope, you will get TM and STM. From that, you will get the particle size, morphology, structure, how my catalyst structure is there. Because structure also is very, very important, spherical, triangular, bipyramidal. From NMR also, I will get the NMR signal. On that basis, I can judge the phase of the any material, acidity, basicity, that also useful. UV spectroscopy, that is also useful for to measure the oxygen state and the complexity of the molecule. So all these techniques based on this discovery of your electromagnetic spectrum. So what it gives, basically it gives textual properties of your catalyst, physical properties and chemical properties. And then open under spectroscopy also people are talking. That technique basically, it is useful to study the catalytic property under reaction. Means under reaction, the reaction is happening on the catalyst. I am passing the reactor and I will focus all the cameras with the technique, not only camera. This I will do the online, my XRD or XPS or FTIR. I will focus on the catalyst reactor and I will understand the catalytic property, how the catalyst property are changing during the reaction. And a lot of research is going on in this area. So basically, this is all about the catalyst characterization. So catalyst characterization is very important. If anybody is working in the catalysis, he should know all the technique. All these techniques we are learning in BSc, MSc level. So characterization, all the topic of analytical chemistry or the spectroscopy. So spectroscopy basically is very useful technique for understanding the catalyst. Now coming to the, once you prepare the catalyst, which is I told you different shapes and body. So crush strength means the strength of the particle is very important, because if you prepare a catalyst on larger scale, like 100 ton, because our capacities are like big 5 ton, 10 ton, so big volumes are there. So when we have to fix the catalyst, we have to fill in the reactor, SS reactor. So catalyst should be very strong. So that is a crush strength also measure. Crush strength is for that, it should not create any fine in the catalyst bed, and which could create, should not create any pressure drop across the reactor. Then the term attrition encompasses all those processes producing fine. So crush strength and attrition loss, these are also important properties for any fixed bed or fluidized bed catalyst. Why? See, these are the spherical catalyst, and if your catalyst is not strength, or if it is, it has not good constitution or attrition loss, it will break during the process, and it can create a safety hazards also, and it will reduce the productivity. So for that reason, this crushing strength and attrition properties are also important for the commercial catalyst, industrial catalyst. Now coming to some of the case studies, I will show you why these catalysts are important, what type of chemical we can make, and how these catalyst properties are important. So this is one of the chemical we are making, vinyl chloride. This is a PVC pipe raw material. So formula is very simple, CH2CHCl. Basically, This is used as a, all the PVC pipe, you can all know the applications, all the PVC pipe applications, there are tremendous applications. And this is a widely used plastic after polyethylene polypropylene. It is used in construction because it is a cheaper, stronger and more traditional alternatives such as copper or ductile. It is a cost effective. How it is manufactured in larger scale, you have to take ethylene, HCl, oxygen. This is oxidative chlorination. Then if you see, we will make the ethylene dichloride. Again, the ethylene dichloride, we have to crack. Then we will get this monomer of phenyl chloride. And then the phenyl chloride has to be polymerized. But in this process, when you make ethylene, oxygen and HCl, you have to use copper-based catalyst. So this is your catalyst, cylindrical form catalyst, where copper supported alumina. So where the role of catalyst is very important. Without catalyst, the reaction will not happen. So with the catalyst, the reaction, we can do at 300 to 400 degree temperature. You can see here, this is a reactor, ethylene, HCl air is going, and whole reaction is happening on the fixed bed reactor, and we are getting the product. The side product also we will get. Then the catalyst, life is 2 years. After 2 years, you have to change the catalyst. But catalyst understanding is very important. So if somebody can develop the better catalyst, right now is copper catalyst, where there is a degradation of the catalyst, stability of the catalyst, then it is a big impact on the society and industry. And then it can enhance the other cost of the process. So you can see one of the catalytic example I am showing, copper on alumina. So there are different metal. And this this reaction is also highly exothermic. So catalyst also takes some energy because alumina we are using as a support material. So most of the relatively low cost ethylene, most phenyl chloride has been produced since 1950. Narayan also is producing more than 500 KT of this VCM material at different locations. So this is one of the important material in India we are producing, which has a wide applications in different sectors. But you can see the role of the catalyst is very important. Without catalyst, this reaction will not happen. But still, there is scope to further improve the catalyst, this catalyst. Now, second example, I want to show purified terephthalic acid that we are making in the Alliance and outside also. So this is purified terephthalic acid. Basically, it is made from paraxylene. Paraxylene is a chemical we are making in-house. Then you have to do the oxidation of paraxylene, pyridoxine, pyridoxine acid, and then followed by carboxybenzaldehyde and pyridoxine acid. Your target molecule is terephthalic acid. This is required to make the polyester. But what happens during this process, when this paraxylene oxidizes, there is an impurity, 4-carboxybenzaldehyde is also formed around 500 ppm, which impact on this terephthalic acid quality. If you don't remove this impurity, then the color of the terephthalic acid will be yellowish. Then you will know, and quality is to be completely pure and white. So then what we do basically here also to convert this carboxybenzaldehyde to pyridoxine acid, which is soluble in water. So then when you give the treatment of water treatment to terephthalic acid, this product after hydrogenation, it will be water soluble. And then immediately, easily you can crystallize this pyridoxine acid, terephthalic acid. And this is a flow sheet of the plant, how we are making the catalyst. So this is a catalyst used palladium on carbon catalyst. So there also catalyst role is very important. 0.5% carbon platinum is supported on carbon or carbon nanotubes. That catalyst will convert all this carboxybenzaldehyde to toluic acid. And there also large quantity of catalyst is requirement of that. But there also, this catalyst also has a lot of challenges. You have to use this catalyst in water. So carbon can be water sensitive. Water is not sensitive, it's a hydrophobic material. And then carbon, this palladium leaching issue also is there. So if you develop further the catalyst, this also, there is a lot of potential of this process. So this is also a big requirement for any industry who is making this terephthalic acid. Coming to one more application, ethylene oxide. This is a look simple molecule, but it is very challenging to make. Ethylene and oxygen, but it has a lot of challenges due to exothermicity and process condition. But it has wide application. If you make ethylene oxide, monoethylene glycol, it is used as a polyester fiber, PET engines, cooling oil, we can use a cooler in our batteries. Then scrubbing, cleaning, cosmetics, polyethylene glycol, you all know, ethoxylated detergent, high quality detergent, there is ethoxylate, ethers, breaking fluids, which has used, then polyurethane foams, whatever you are seeing right now, the mattress, foam mattress, whole thing has been made from ethylene oxide and propyl oxide. So all the synthetic foams basically, for the your sofas, your bed, so that we are making for the polyols. So ethylene oxide is very important chemical. Again, these glycols, lubricant in your car, two-wheeler, or any industrial applications that also has been used. So RIL is also a major producer of ethylene oxide. We have 4 or 5 plants, and this is very important material. You can see PET bottles, whatever we are seeing today, that is also raw material is ethylene oxide and ethylene glycol. So how we make this ethylene oxide? There also, role of catalyst again is very important. Without catalyst, the reaction will not happen. So the reaction looks very simple. See, ethylene plus oxygen, and then we are making ethylene oxide. Okay, but this reaction is exothermic reaction, uncontrollable reaction. Only silver is the catalyst which was discovered 50 years ago. So still silver supported alumina is used for this process. And interestingly, this process, you will surprise that only 10% conversion is there and 90% selectivity. So if you increase the conversion, then you have to control the exothermicity. This is a real challenge for the researcher and scientists who are working worldwide in the world to develop this process. And selectivity is 90%. So if you develop the selectivity more than 91% also, it has a big benefit. The side product is CO2. So you will again get the carbon credit if you reduce the CO2 formation in this reaction. So if you see the innovation in this catalysis, silver catalysis, only silver metal is there, but innovation in terms of the recipe, in terms of silver distribution, so a lot of innovation has happened. In 1949, the selectivity was 40%. Now, if you see in 2020, the selectivity is 91%. So still there is a window to improve the selectivity. But there are many challenges. It's a highly expensive catalyst. Because silver is around 30% silver is used on the catalyst support. Support is alumina support. And then you have to use different promoters to control the silver oxidation. So silver oxidation also is very important. Silver should be in silver oxide form, and then when it reacts with oxygen, it will form electrophilic oxygen and nucleophilic oxygen. Okay, so electrophilic oxygen is required to form the ethylene oxide. If you get nucleophilic oxygen, then this ethylene oxide will burn to CO2. So it is very important dissociation of oxygen on silver surface. So that is also a lot of study has been done by people, and a lot of chemistry is involved. So that just I will show you one chemistry. See, this is the silver, different phases are formed by catalyst, by different process. So shapes are very important. When the trigonal shape is there, you can see here, bipyramidal shape is there, then you will get CO2 and H2O. But if you change the shape, this type of shape, quasi spherical, which has a high index plane basically, then you will get majority of the EO product. So basically what happens, we have to create a high index plane basically, silver planes, which is responsible to form the ethylene oxide. So for that, this SEM, TM, electrolysis techniques are very important. Without that, you can't judge this catalyst, how it is behaving. So to understand the mechanism, this type of understanding and characterization is important. Now coming to one more area where we are making linear alkyl benzenes. Basically, this is LAB. So whatever this right now, you are seeing this detergent, Rin hai, ya koi bhi, any detergent, the raw material is linear alkyl benzene. How it is made? It is made from benzene and chloride, any chloride, heterogeneous chloride, like isobutyl chloride or paraffins, olefins. So it should be, the structure of LAB is like that, linear alkyl benzene, because it is a linear, molecules are there, big chain is there, C18 change is there, that is binded to benzene. How it is made? It is made from paraffin. First paraffin, C10 to C13, basically carbon number, aliphatic chain. It is dehydrogenated by using, here also again the catalyst is important. See, this catalyst are developed in 1960, which is a platinum based catalyst. So, which is very important. Here also paraffin converted to monoolefin. There also the conversion is only 10%, but at industry level we are recycling the remaining paraffin. But here also if somebody develops the catalyst with higher conversion, it will change the game. So here the challenge is that life, catalyst life is only 60 to 70 days in the commercial life. So if can make the effective catalyst, then we can change the life of the catalyst. So in R&D, as we are working in R&D, we have made the catalyst, you can see here, this is a spherical catalyst, which has a core shell structure. Earlier the catalyst was not core shell structure. Then we have made the core shell structure to reduce the diffusion path length of the molecule. So by doing the change, we could increase the life 30 to 40%. So that R&D we have done, we almost worked 5 years on this catalyst, and then we have commercialized this catalyst in our plant. But still I will say, further increase the life is very important. We can go to only 70 days, but if you do the more research, so all research is going on still, research is going on to further increase the catalytic activity. And demand is, all over demand, lot of demand is there for this LAB, for all washer, dishwasher and detergents. So here you can see how catalyst characterization is important. So these are the platinum particles. We have supported alumina, and the size is 1 nanometer only. Can you believe we can make the catalyst with platinum 1 nanometer? Because for this application, we need lower particle size. But there is a special preparation methods are there. Whatever the catalyst preparation method I have shown. So for that, basically, the role of the implication is very critical. So if you see, the particles are uniformly distributed. So that is the reason how I can assess key this uniform distribution by HRTM characterization. So I have done SEM, HRTM. So characterization make a major role in your catalyst development. Then you can further develop the catalyst. Here you can see the SEM image of the red alumina. Two alumina we are bind together. So you can see it is like mass on the earth that has created, because this is our layered alumina. Inside is a core alumina, and this layer we have made. But if you do in the color formation, the layer formation is like that. So that also is very important. The layer thickness also is very important. This layer thickness, the porosity of the layer structure, layer UL, all these things are critical for your catalyst development. Now coming to the one more catalyst, we have developed oxidation catalyst. This is in-house catalyst we have developed. And R&D, our team, we are involved in that catalyst. And that is basically oxidation catalyst. What does catalyst do? We make the PET pestiles. Pestiles means solid state polymerization. This ethylene glycol and this terephthalic acid. And we make the PET polyethylene terephthalate. This is a process. What happened? We make this solid state polymerization. Large quantity of nitrogen has been used in that process. And when the nitrogen recycle, along with that, some of the impurities of this hydrocarbon, aldehyde, acetaldehyde, formaldehyde, that comes with the catalyst. So then what we have to do, we have to convert that impurities into CO2, because we want to recycle that nitrogen, because nitrogen is very expensive. If you don't recycle that nitrogen, your cost will be very high. So what we have done, we have developed one catalyst, platinum-based catalyst, to convert that impurities, this ethylene glycol impurities, into CO2 and water. Then again, you can recycle the nitrogen. So that whole catalyst has been developed at R&D, which is also platinum-based catalyst. So you can see here, this is the catalyst we have made, lab scale and commercial catalyst. So performance of our commercial catalyst was better than our lab catalyst and even market catalyst. So we have saved a lot of money with this catalyst, and what we have shown, in-house catalyst showed almost 20% better performance for total oxidation. And this catalyst also, you can see, platinum nanoparticle uniformly dispersed on alumina. So here also, role of the distribution is very important, and particle size around 5 nanometer. So here also the challenge is, now right now we are doing this the catalyst operation at 300 degree temperature, but if somebody could develop the catalyst at 200 or 100 degree temperature, then it will be really game changer. So this type of research I think is important. We should do as a academic or research institute, we should develop such type of catalyst, and then maybe industry collaboration will be there, then industry job will be the scale up of the catalyst. But a fundamental thinking should be there, okay, yeah, I had to develop the catalyst with this milestone, and objective is to develop the catalyst at low temperature. So there are a lot of challenges to develop this catalyst. Now there are, I will catch up of important area, volatile organic compounds. Basically, if you see all the volatile compounds, they have atmospheric pressure, low boiling point. And there are a lot, wide class of this compound, like alkane, alcohol, ketone, aldehyde, aromatics, paraffin, olefins, halogenate hydrocarbons. And basically this impact on our human body. So even ozone depletion, smog formation, climate change, sick building syndromes. If you see, if you stay in like big city, Mumbai or Bangalore, or where the pollution is Delhi more. So you ask that people, they will say they are suffering from this cough, sardi whole year, because a lot of VOC are generating from the cars and industry, and they are impacting on their health. So it is very important now. Government also is making a lot of initiatives like fuel cars, car, electric car. Even we are coming different processes where we can generate the lower waste. But certainly, we have to come with solution, but we can't avoid few things, but at least we can reduce the VOCs. So there are various processes for that, like VOC source, chemical plant, petroleum refineries, pharmaceutical plant, automobile, paint industries, food industry, because these are important. Otherwise, if you don't make this product, we can't survive, because for survival, for transportation, all chemicals are important. But definitely, we have to sustain, for sustainability, we have to develop the solution also. So that is the reason R&D's role is very important to develop the sustainable solution. And if you see, there are more than 1,000 different VOCs are there in the all the total industries. So what are the options? Options are, yeah, solid adsorbent are used that can capture your VOC. You know, carbon cartridge are there. Condense, you can condense this VOC. It should not go in the atmosphere. Membranes is there. Thermal insulation, you can burn completely. There is one option. You can burn VOC into CO2. So outside of atmosphere, there will be no VOC. Photocatalytic option is there. Catalytic insulation, if you use catalyst to burn this VOC, then definitely the cost will be lower and lower temperature. If you do thermal insulation, you have to do at 1000 degree temperature. So catalyst insulation is preferred. So you can see the impact of this VOC on the globally. So around WHO, as per WHO study, 7 million people currently die prematurely every year. This could be are surpassed by the death caused by the rising temperature and extreme weather if emission continue to rise at present rates. So you can see the level of the emissions. So these are very important area for as a R&D people or industrial area, industrial scientist. So there's also a lot of work is going on. We are aggressively working on this now development to reduce the CO2 emission. One process this I want to show we have developed by R&D, where benzene is the VOC which is coming from the tanker loading. When we load the tanker, so release of the emission of the benzene around 200 ppm. Then we have developed one process, catalyst-based process. There, what we did, see, here you can see the picture, loading of the benzene in the pump, and then there is a air which is used to deplete the vapor pressure of the benzene. But the service air is coming out, some of the ppm of benzene is coming out. So those who are working in nearby region, it will impact on their health. So we have developed one solution for that. We have put our catalyst at the vent line. We have put, and then the catalyst is converting all your benzene to CO2, you can see. Benzene 7.5 molecule of oxygen. So that catalyst process we have developed, which is a platinum-based catalyst. So you can see like that application we are developing in R&D and we are sustaining the process. Apart from that, many chemicals we are making from last more than 50 years, and without that chemicals, it is very difficult to sustain ourselves. So these are the important chemicals we are making, several oxidation, and one of that industrial oxidation process is very important. If you see organic chemistry also, there are many catalysts which are the oxidation, but oxidation form we can make many chemicals. In oxidation, transition and noble metal catalysts are used. So if you take sulfuric acid, there we are using contact process. The catalyst is vanadium pentoxide process, which is go for sulfuric fertilizer production. But still, the process we are using from CuSO2 to SO3, still their conversion is low. You have to recycle SO3. So still challenges are there. So I think work can be focused on development of the process as well as catalyst. And that is a wide demand for sulfuric acid. It is not like that we are sulfuric acid we are getting from the market. But still there are a lot of scope to develop the catalyst process in sulfuric acid production. Likewise, same nitric acid, there also we are using Ostwald process. There also platinum-based catalyst is used, but there are challenges. We can develop further better process for nitric acid production, which is very important for fertilizer and this depends also nitric acid production. So apart from that, formaldehyde, which are used as a food grade application, Formac process is there. There also we are using iron molybdenum-based catalyst, and there also the challenges are exothermicity, high temperature, selectivity. So applications are in resin basically, phenol formaldehyde resin. Whatever the resin we are using, that is the raw material of that. So there also a lot of scope is there to improve this formaldehyde process, methanol formaldehyde. Import is acetaldehyde. Acetaldehyde also is make commercially produced by palladium and copper process, Wacker process. There also the issues are selectivity issue, ethanol to acetaldehyde or ethylene to acetaldehyde. There also we can look that process, and researcher can develop the better process of core chemistry for acetaldehyde production. Likewise, ethylene oxide, already I talked, there are many challenges because million of dollar crores we are spending on this catalyst to buy. And if you develop our own catalyst or a low cost catalyst, then definitely a lot of delta will be there and environmental issue, waste generation will be less. So like that, malic anhydride also important chemical we are making from butane. So still we are using vanadium phosphate catalyst. So there are a lot of scope to improve the process efficiency of this process. Acronitrile, it also goes in defense carbon fiber. So there also still the Sohail process is there. Bismuth and molybdenum oxide catalyst is there. There also, if you develop a better catalyst system, which can again improve the process of your Sohail process. Terephthalic acid, already I explained you, manganese and cobalt salt are used for paraxylene oxidation. So there also a lot of phase generation is there. So still we can further improve this catalyst, but a lot of challenges are there and a lot of efforts are required. Like that phenyl acetate and atom exhaust catalyst. So there also atom exhaust catalyst, if you could replace this platinum, palladium and rhodium noble metal with a non-noble metal catalyst like zinc, copper, cobalt, then the cost of the catalyst again will reduce. And not only catalytic converter, it can be used for other VOC emissions that I have shown. So VOC emissions also, I already have covered that area, and that also we are working very seriously. So if you see all these things, just I want to convey you that there are many challenges for catalysis or people where they should give the focus. And they should do work for the society. So if you see globally, around 483,000 ton of the catalyst has been produced for this oxidation purpose. But still, there are a lot of challenges to work out and to deliver. And then it will give the real picture. Because if you work in the lab on different chemistry and if you scale up, so then the satisfaction will be different and impact will be there in terms of economics. So I want to convey that in oxidation, there are a lot of challenges for researcher. One area, I want to touch the spent HCC catalyst. Basically, we are making propylene at Jamnagar, and there we are using the HCC catalyst. That is this chloride-based HCC catalyst. There the particle size is very important. And almost 20 ton per day of the catalyst generated at site. Then spent catalyst, it goes as the landfilling. Otherwise, you have to develop some application. So here we tried to develop the application of spent catalyst basically. So spent catalyst, what will happen? Spent catalyst, rather than it goes to landfilling, if you can develop some catalytic application. So see, this is spent HCC catalyst, which has a broken particle. Okay. We have done some chemistry on that hydrothermal treatment and some exchanging, some metal exchange. And then we try to recycle that catalyst. After treatment, you can see the shape also has changed, and which has a trigonal shape. And then the morphology also and the change. So that advantage we have taken, we have tried to develop a process. This catalyst we can use for alkylation, triddle carb alkylation. You all know triddle carb alkylation is basically used for this alkylated product and acetylated product. Means alkylation of benzene with benzyl chloride. So you can make the higher molecule. Acetophenol we can make by triddle carb alkylation or diphenyl methane. So what we have done? We have done the reaction for that. We have developed the catalyst in the lab. So what we have found? Spent HCC catalyst, the surface area is only 150, but after converting, it has gone up to 490. So again, we can recycle this catalyst. So we have developed one more application for spent HCC catalyst. So that also can be explored. Like that, there are many applications can be explored for spent HCC catalyst. One more area is activated carbon. You all know activated carbon has wide applications in many sector like water treatment, whatever the water we are using at our home also, that also treatment to remove the impurities, gas purifications, pharmaceutical medicine, other food beverage, remove the contamination. So this is a big market of activated carbon and they widely use because it has a specific properties like activity distribution, porosity, particle size, mechanical stability, abrasion, durability, thermal stability, bulk density, at least deactivation is slow. So activated carbon is highly porous material, right? So porous material will absorb all the impurities as per their porosity and it is a hydrophobic. Okay, so water will not absorb on the activated carbon. And then it will use for water purification as a gas application. So see, this is the structure of activated carbon. You can see very beautiful structure like buildings. These are the pores basically, fresh carbon that we have identified by SEM. This we have done the work on this. After spent, all the blocks, the pores have been blocked. Then this material is not active. Again, you have to regenerate. But after regeneration means you have to remove the coke formation or adsorb molecule from the catalyst. So you can see here, regenerate catalyst. The pores has been clean, but not that much clean. So that type of understanding is very important. Analysis is important to give the life, understand the life of the activated carbon. So this is the industrial carbon we are using for various processes. A lot of work also has been going on in this area. And this is also a very promising material for the researcher to develop an application for catalyst and separations. Now coming to the factor of it on the catalyst. Any catalyst, we have seen the catalyst preparation, catalyst impact, and catalyst process, but any catalyst has the life. All the catalyst can't work for long life, not for 1 year, 2 year, 5 years. Every catalyst life has some life. Why? Because there is a deactivation of the catalyst. Because catalyst is porous, metal is there. So what happens with continuous process, if you are making any chemical, the coke formation will be there. So then on the catalyst, due to coke, the blockage will be there. And then pore will be blocked by the catalyst, metal surface also blocked. And that metal and this pore will not available for the reaction. So one area, then catalyst will deactivate. In other case, poisoning. There are some impurities like sulfur, arsenic, selenium, but this also will cause the catalyst deactivation because this will capture your metal. It will form a bond with metal and it will not available for the next reaction. So that is also important. In your feed or in your chemical reactant, this impurity should not be there. Then high temperature, if you increase the catalytic reactor, basically the heat exothermicity will happen in the reaction. Like if I am doing the reaction at 300 degree temperature, but suddenly if there is a temperature enhancement due to some issue, hotspot, then it will impact my catalyst particle. You can see there is a particle growth of centering of the particle growth. That is due to atomic migration. The molecule will migrate and then on atomic level and then particle size will grow. And as you know, nanocatalyst, if you see particle size grow, then your performance will go down. So crystal growth and centering resulting in loss of activity of surface area. So that is very important to understand the catalyst deactivation mechanism. Without that, we can't develop a better catalyst. So deactivation of the catalyst is one of the most investigated problem in industrial catalysis. Due to it, negative impact on both the catalyst. Because if the catalyst is deactivated, you have to change. And if you change, then one catalyst costs around maybe 10 crore. And if you regenerate, So then cost will be reduced. So that is also make impact for the industry. So deactivation of the catalyst is very important to improve your process. But for mechanism also, understanding is very important. So you could control the catalyst deactivation. So this you can see one example, silver and aluminum catalyst for ethyl oxide production that I have shown. It's a fresh catalyst, particle are very well distributed. Size is around 80 nanometer. This is the catalyst after 100 hours. Particle size has grown to 100 to 200 nanometer. But after 14 months operation, this is the actual catalyst we took out from the plant and we have checked the particle size. So it is around 1000 nanometer. So like this sintering happened. So once the particle size has grown up to 1000 nanometer, its activity will go down. Activity will not produce ethyl oxide. So it is very important to maintain the particle size 100 nanometer. So that is the real challenge. If you do something in the process or in the catalyst, your catalyst will not deactivate. So this is a major problem in chemical technology. In the lab, you can make the catalyst very good, very well in the lab, but that catalyst should sustain the commercial operation and that should not lead to the particle size increase. So sometimes what will happen if you prepare any catalyst that is working very well in the lab, so but there is no use, because if you scale up that catalyst and if you don't perform that catalyst like lab catalyst, then that catalyst has no use. So real challenge is to convert lab to commercial catalyst. So a lot of chemistry, a lot of understanding, a lot of processes, chemical equipments are required. And a lot of experiences are required, handling of the chemicals, SCL, safety. So all these understanding will helpful to develop better and better catalyst. Now I'm showing one slide. There, what are the efforts are required to develop the catalyst from lab scale to commercial scale? Then you will understand a lot of integration is required, different teams integration, different knowledge, different expertise, not only one person. It is a teamwork. Then only we can dream a big catalyst development. See, this is a chart you can say. Idea, it will start from idea. If I want to work on some work like methanol or formaldehyde synthesis, then what type of idea I should have, what type of catalyst I should develop, then synthesis on lab scale, primary screening, then secondary screening on higher scale, mechanism, kinetics, stability test. After that, you have to scale up the catalyst process, scale up pilot testing, reactor designing, pilot testing, everything we have to plan. And then performance has to be matched with commercial performance. And then particle size also, crystal agglomerate size you should get. And then ultimately the catalyst should perform. So what we have observed, when you go from lab scale to commercial scale, there are a lot of challenges and it takes effort to make the catalyst. So I think all understanding is required. So those who are working in catalyst development, in terms of industrial development or any industry collaboration, so he should know all these things, because definitely industry will look all these aspects of industrial catalysis. So this will be a very good integration of the team. So sometimes it takes 2 years, 3 years, 5 years, depend on the catalyst and depend on your team efficiency, passion for the work. So that is very important to deliver any task or any project. Coming to the new technique which are coming in the catalysis now, artificial intelligence and machine learning. You may heard about, now there are a lot of discussion on artificial intelligence and machine learning, but how this is helpful for catalyst selection. So if you see, AI is a penetrating entry to be remarkable in various fields. Science, basically it is a data management or computer. And then all instruments are now our database. We are generating a lot of data from the catalyst, understanding, testing and evaluation. So this machine learning will use to learn from the data, detect pattern and make the fast and accurate. So our development will be fast. If you adopt this technique, artificial intelligence and machine learning, then my development time will be reduced. See, here I am given an example how it will be useful. This is, I am designing the catalyst and synthesis. I am understanding the mechanism. And I am catalyst database I am making. But machine learning, it will be useful to reduce my time. If I want to make 100 catalyst, so it will helpful to design and make the basis key. I can do my job with 10 catalyst. So that database already has been done with DFT studies on one of the team. And that has recently published with the kinetic model. They have shown that one of the example like NO decomposition, nitride oxide decomposition can form on rhodium and gold catalyst, alloy particle. But he has studied the different particle size and then he has tried to prepare the catalyst based on the particle size required. So then his whole efforts will be on the 3 nanometer size. If he is getting high efficiency, then he will not prepare the catalyst with 5 nanometer or 2 nanometer. So in this way, your efforts will go down, your time will reduce and we could do a better catalyst with the help of this artificial intelligence learning. So nowadays, these are also important tools for the catalysis scientist. Coming to the chemical from oils, now maybe you are also reading in many news or many scientific publications, research publications, people are talking about oil to chemical. means oil to chemical is simple. Whatever the oil we are getting from Saudi Arabian or other sources, that we have to convert directly chemical. Otherwise, we are first refining, we are making diesel, petrol. But now, if you see, there is a trend changing due to our electric cars. Maybe after 10, 15 years, we may get all the cars will be electric cars. So then the dependency on the kerosene, gasoline, diesel will be less. So then what we'll do with oil? So there are a lot of markets for these petrochemicals. So if you could make directly, but there are also many of challenges, but people have started the work. All major industries, they have started the work to convert directly chemicals to oil. So that will sustain your chemicals and that will produce the chemical with more efficiency with the, in terms of cost and reduction of the CO2, because a lot of CO2 also is generated in this process. So that was overall objective. Now again, people are talking about the circular economy. Maybe circular economy, linear economy, reuse economy. So what is that term basically? That also we should know as a scientist or as a researcher, faculty, student. So linear economy means any raw material. If I am using any raw material, for example, I am making any polythene bag, then I am producing from ethylene, polyethylene, use non-recyclable. It is going to waste and it is having burden on my atmosphere, environment, on my country. So now people first talk about reuse economy. If whatever I am producing, can I recycle that? So raw material production, use. No, if I recycle, then it will go under reuse economy. At least whatever I am making the waste, I can recycle the waste. Means it is a reuse economy. Means I am not throwing anything outside my process and it will reduce the burden. Now, one more term is circular economy. There, whatever produce, use and recycle. Everything. Here I will say 50%. But now people are talking about circular economy. And this is widely used for various processes. Now our next word will be the circular economy. In any process, not only petrochemical refinery, but target will be to circular economy. So whatever we produce, I think it should be recycled, reused. Again, we can make the raw material out of that. So 95% to 100%. And catalysis is the central element to enable to help the circular economy, keeping the molecule in play. So catalyst, role of the catalyst will be very, very, very important to develop the circular economy. So one example, RIL is one of the largest recycler of PET. We are making the PET bottles, raw material. But now everybody has realized we have to recycle that bottles and we have to make the chemicals bottle. So RIL already has the largest recycle facility of PET consumer, all these bottles. And already currently we are recycling 2 billion such bottles in different plants. We have different plants in Gujarat. And the target may be next in 2020 now, by December, it will be more than 5 million bottles that we are targeting to convert, again recycle the bottle. So this is basically to help the environment and to reduce the impact of this waste, bottles and anything. So first objective of the bottle, because that will be widely used for the Bisleri bottle and other drinkable juice, other medias. So that work is going on. So already 2 million bottles we are already recycling. And not only bottles, even we are recycling the cost wealth here, this wearing cloths also. That also process we have developed. Now coming to the just last two slides, raw material issue and challenges. Now we talk many things about catalyst. So where we are going? So as a future sustainability, there are many things we are talking, direct conversion of methane. Methane basically is available in large quantity. If you all of us know from shale gas also, methane is available. If you could make methane as a future fuel, so we can make olefin, aromatics and hydrogen. So a lot of research and process are going on that. Some challenges also are there, but future will be the methane. Then oil to chemical, already I talked on that. What are the challenges? Companies are talking about methane to chemical to make the balances. And again, the on purpose means like alkane dehydrogenation, olefin methasis, direct if you do the ethane, propane, butane dehydrogenation, and purposefully you can make the olefins, that also will be helpful to sustain this process. And shale chemical, that will be the technology disruptor, I will say, and which will be the techno-economic shift also. If you convert this shale to chemicals, it's all methane, ethane, directly if you could convert to petrochemicals, then it will be definitely reduce the cost. Then again, strategic analysis, what the strategy is saying in by next 20 years or 25 years. So although catalysts are employed a important role to making the chemicals, ethylene, methanol, aromatics, what we are making the chemicals by catalyst. Catalyst market is growing positively, influenced by the design in the chemical industry. So which will continue, and the effect of successful market crude to chemical, there also we have to understand the catalyst requirement, because without catalyst, it will not happen crude to chemical future. And this OCM also, oxidative coupling of methane, that also people are looking. There also role of catalyst is very important. And then all these things, if you do, all our objective is to reduce the carbon capture and utilization of CCU, carbon capture utilization. So that people are talking green petrochemistry, and all the world is looking to reduce the carbon capture. So our management also is looking to reduce the carbon emissions by 2035. And all of them, if you see, use of hydrogen catalyst, whatever we talk, is again useful for bio feedstock, particularly lignocellulosic, non-food resources that we are talking to make the chemical ethylene, propylene. So in that process also, this role of hydrogen catalyst will be very critical. That also future point of view. If you see the energy reduction, if you make any chemical, energy is very important. Most of the cost coming from energy. So you all of know, you should know where we are spending a lot of energy. So you see, these are the chemicals we are making, ethylene oxide, paraxylene, styrene, dixylene, polyethylene. Highest is ammonia. Ammonia we are making, you all of know, we are making the ammonia from nitrogen and hydrogen, and that ammonia is going for our urea production. So more than 400 million ton ammonia is produced. But advantage is that some of the CO2 also we are using as a raw material for ammonia production. But if you see in terms of the energy consumption, it's the highest energy consumption process because it is a high temperature, high process. Nitrogen, hydrogen, temperature and pressure. If somebody could develop this process at low temperature, this will be the real game changer. I will say this is a Nobel Prize work. If somebody could do the process at low temperature, so you will see a lot of people now coming in Nature also. There people have developed different catalysts and they are targeting ammonia synthesis at room temperature, 100 degree temperature. So that will be real shift, I will say, in the scientific area or scientific knowledge. Ethylene also, energy is required. So I think this type of challenges we should know for the researcher, for next generation scientist. And then only, I think we could develop a better chemistry with this type of processes. So all the chemicals are important chemicals. If you take any name, all of these are commodity chemicals, which are required for our human and society. Lastly, future opportunities, I want to just convey. There are a lot of opportunities who are working in the catalysis. First is the direct conversion of crude oil. People are talking now that is a dream, but people are looking along the perspective. CO2, a lot of CO2 is available. You all of know, million ton of the CO2 is available if you convert to chemical, and there are people are working also to convert the CO2 to chemical, and some chemicals also are coming. And then under the circular economy, waste plastic. If you develop a better process for waste plastic, because a lot of waste is generated from plastic. So if you develop better process, definitely any industry will take that process, and that will also be viable for our health as well as our country. Then novel material for selective oxidation, catalysis and VOC, that also I have touched up. Okay, VOC, a lot of VOC generation is there, and definitely we have to come up with better catalyst. So if you develop room temperature catalyst, then definitely it will help for your home also. At the flat we are staying, if any VOC is coming, then I think it should pass to the catalyst. An alternative catalyst for the costly noble metals, like we have seen that we are using the mostly noble metals, platinum, palladium and silver, but if you replace with this noble metal with this metal, then the cost will be less. Alternative energy sources, now we are talking hydrogen as a future fuel. So electrochemistry, photochemistry, future, this fuel cell, which are very important. That area also is tremendously growing. So maybe if you can see latest report on this alternative energy sources, I have put on the LinkedIn under Catalyst Society of India. We are actively working. We have the group on Catalyst Society of India on LinkedIn. So you all student or researcher can join. You will get latest update in catalysis, where our country is going. Scientists, this Department of Science and Technology has published a 100-page report. You all get what are the labs they are doing research. More than 100 labs are doing research in India. What are the industry collaboration? Then you can do research, and even BSc, MSc student, they will get opportunity. There are a lot of scope and jobs are available in this area, but your efforts should be sincere. And then you have to evolve yourself and you have to continue for the research. And this is the last slide. I will say, if you want to make yourself expert in the catalysis or any area, what are the things required? So definitely you have to understand capability difference. It should be different. You should know the latest what is going in catalyst area, like the quality and quantity of equipments, theoretical chemical engineering skills, and then high throughput experimentation. Then the industrial success to make any catalyst or any process, deep understanding of catalyst mechanism, ability to improve based empirical knowledge. Challenging feedstock also you should know. Right now, feedstock is changing. Earlier, you know, we are making the JETROPHA, we are using JETROPHA for biofuel, but now nobody is talking on JETROPHA. People are looking more resources. It should not have the food versus fuel competition. So then challenges you should know. Again, future need, adapt to future, feedstock future, catalyst for production of energy vector, circular economy, what do we talk? So all these things, you have to understand the build, capability build in this area. C1 chemistry, CO2 utilization, new steel, cement, oil refineries, to capture the carbon, utilize the waste, reduce the waste. And then you have to update the knowledge, day-to-day knowledge. Then it will helpful to get the expertise in this catalysis, and you could demonstrate many processes. And it will be, I think, big achievement for our country. So we have required large pool of the catalysis for our country also, because we are working in different areas. So most of the catalysts we are importing from outside. But now it is a time to develop our own catalyst in India, and we should get credential for that. So with that, I would like to thank you. This is our Mumbai R&D Center. If you see, Reliance has a big R&D corporate center in Mumbai, Reliance Corporate Park. There 500 scientists are working in different cross-cutting technologies. So we have almost all the equipment, if you take name, SEM, HRTM. So a lot of money has been spent, more than 500 crore to build on this R&D and to develop the cross-cutting technologies for the society and in this, our company. And apart from that, we have R&D center at Vadodara, Jamnagar, all site supporting R&D also is there. So this is a future. I think a lot of futures are there, and there are opportunities are there in research. If somebody want to do the research, want to make the PhD and research in this area. And finally, I would like to thank Reliance R&D Management to present this work, my group R&D Chemical Synthesis Catalysis Group, and organizing committee of TCC 2020-2021. And I wish to 2021 this TCC organizing committee to organize such type of seminar in future and to make the integration within the teams. So this is basically my teams. You see my R&D teams, research team at Baroda, and research team in Mumbai. So all these are the scientists, technical staff. So these are the young people. You can see all our MSc, PhD, and all our level of people are there to support, experienced people are there. This is our R&D head, Dr. R.V. Jasra, who is heading our catalysis group in Reliance. So with that, I think I would like to end my presentation. And if you have any question, any doubt, if you want any guidance, you can contact me on my mail ID or phone also. So I can support, if anybody I can support, I will be happy to give any guidance also. So this is my background. Basically, I did my PhD from ICT Mumbai, and followed by I did my postdoctorate from Padma Shri G.D. Yadav, who is the first VC of this ICT Mumbai. And followed by I did my postdoctorate in Canada for 2 years in catalysis. And I joined the Reliance organization in 2007. And from that, now I have developed the skills, and we are working on many teams. We have developed the people and many technology we are commercializing, and we are generating the value for the organization. So with this, I conclude my presentation here. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Such a nice presentation by Dr. Sharad Lande. He talked on industry's catalysis, opportunity and challenges. I like his presentation specially to discuss the three types of economy: linear economy, reuse economy, and circular economy. In the current situation, circular economy is most important. He discusses the opportunities for young researchers and challenges in front of our countries. Thank you very much, sir. I request Dr. Sharad Lande, sir, please reply to participant question in future. Thank you, sir.
Let us start today's second section. Hello, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I am Professor Maharudra Dude, Department of Chemistry, Tujaram Chaturchand College, Baramati. It's a great pleasure for me to introduce our today's speaker, Honorable Dr. Ajay Chhatre. He is Senior General Manager, R&D, United Phosphorus Limited, Mumbai, who is going to talk us about polymorphism in chemical product and its application in industrial chemistry. Dr. Ajay Chhatre has completed PhD in chemistry as well as diploma in chemical engineering. He has more than 28 years experience in Indian chemical and agrochemical industry at senior position. His experience in chemical process development, analytical development, chemical and agrochemical product, raw material costing, product profiling, process scale up, HAZOP, plant commission, drug master file preparation and implementation of ISO 9001 and ISO 17025 in chemical industry are really admirable one. He has credited for 5 Indian and 2 US patent as well as 1 Indian and 6 international research publications. He has conducted various corporate, industrial and private seminar and lectures on various topics. He has also participated in conference which were held in Germany and UK. He is a member of Indian Institute of Chemical Engineers, Kolkata, affiliated members of Institution of Engineers, Pune, life member of the Indian Society for Surface Science and Technology, Mumbai. I am sure that after brief introduction of Dr. Ajay Chhatre sir, you all are eager to listen him. So let turns our topic, that is polymorphism in chemical product and its application in industrial chemistry. Over to sir, please.
Very good morning, friends, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Ajay Chhatre and I am going to present today an important topic called polymorphism in chemical products and its application in industrial chemistry. I am sure many of you know this word polymorphism, which was briefly introduced to us in the 12th standard. So today we are going to discuss its importance and its significance in the present industrial context. To begin with, let me start with a few shocking cases of pharmaceutical products which were considered as significant cases in the field of polymorphism. So let us consider a case of a pharma drug called as ritonavir. Basically, ritonavir is an antiviral drug which was developed by Abbott and it is used in the treatment of HIV. This drug was launched in 1996 when one crystalline solid form of the drug was known. The drug began to fail in the FDA approved dissolution specification of 1998. The investigation conducted by Abbott Laboratories, it demonstrated that the compound crystallized in two polymorphic forms, out of which one is thermodynamically more stable and less soluble than the other. So what the Abbott scientists, they could not get or reproduce the original form, and the product had to be scrapped and redeveloped and relaunched in a new formulation of the newly discovered polymorph. This is another case of a product called as acetaminophen, which is paracetamol, and this is the structure, as you already know. This popular drug was discovered in 1878. Two polymorphs of this drug were found in 1998, after almost 120 years. These forms are called monoclinic form 1 and orthorhombic form 2. As you can see, this drug is having a monoclinic form, which is hexagonal in shape. It is more stable, but it cannot be easily compressed into tablets. This form, which is a needle form, it is called as orthorhombic form, but which can be easily compressed into tablet. It has higher solubility, but it is less stable. So the scientist, they discovered that monoclinic form 1 is not suitable because it lacks slip planes in the crystal structure, which were a prerequisite for plastic deformation. Whereas, in contrast, the orthorhombic paracetamol has well-developed slip planes in the crystal structure, and therefore it can undergo plastic deformation easily, and therefore it can be tableted very easily. Another curious case is of metformin ambonate. I am sure many of you know what is metformin hydrochloride. It is a slow-release anti-diabetic drugs formulation. Now, the challenges are that plain metformin hydrochloride has a very high water solubility, and therefore the slow release of this drug is a challenge. There are several side effects of this plain metformin hydrochloride. Therefore, metformin ambonate, this is a derivative of metformin, or I can call it as a salt of metformin. It was introduced as a better solution to the above problems. This product is marketed by Merck under the brand name Stagin. So this is metformin, this is ambonic acid, it forms a salt, and this product is introduced into the market by a company called Merck. Now what happens is metformin ambonate also has two polymorphic forms, form 1 and form 2. How they are analyzed? They are analyzed by a technique called as powder X-ray diffractometry. It was found that the form 1 is having platelet type of crystals, which was more efficacious than the form 2, which are needles and which are less efficacious. So therefore, now you must have understood that polymorphs are really significant in the chemical industry. How they are significant? Because the processing characteristics are improved. Polymorphs are used to change the properties of the drugs, such as flow and compressibility. Polymorphs facilitate various operations such as ease of transportation and storage condition, and also improved shelf life. Due to certain polymorph, the bioavailability of the drugs is improved. For example, in normal penicillin G, which does not dissolve in the gastric fluids, can be converted into a particular polymorph which easily dissolves. Therefore, the bioavailability of this drug is improved. Due to the size and shape of particular polymorph, the sustained release drugs are designed in that way. For example, one of the polymorphs of protamine zinc insulin has a better release rate than the normal polymorph. So now let us understand what actually polymorphism is. As you already know, there are five distinct fundamental forms of matter. We have studied all these in our 12th standard or graduation. These forms are solids, which are bound to each other. The molecules are bound to each other by strong forces of attraction, such as hydrogen bonds, ionic bonds, metallic bonds, etc., etc. Molecules have very low kinetic energy in solids. Another form of matter is liquid, wherein the molecules are bound by very weak forces of attraction, and therefore these molecules can move away from each other, but still they remain bound to each other in a certain way. In case of gases, the molecules are not bound to each other and therefore they are free to move away. There is another state called as plasma, which consists of highly charged particles with extremely high kinetic energy. One more form of matter is called PEC, Bose-Einstein condensate, which are formed at temperatures near absolute zero. Now we will consider various types of bondings in molecules. All these things are actually known. We have different types of bonds which exist in molecules. First one is the ionic bond, wherein electron is transferred from a cation to an anion. Second type of bond is called as a covalent bond, wherein the atoms share pair of electron. Third type of bonding is called as metallic bond, wherein the ions are surrounded by free electrons. The fourth type of bonding is called as molecular bond, wherein weak electrical attraction binds these molecules. For example, a hydrogen bond. So this brings us to the topic of characteristic of solid crystals. There are various types of crystals. For example, number one, covalent crystals, which has true covalent bond between all of the atoms in the crystal. Such type of crystals have very high melting points, and examples are diamond and zinc sulfide crystals. Other type of crystals are called metallic crystals, wherein individual metal ions of the metallic crystal, they sit on lattice sites. These leaves the electrons of these atoms freely to float around the lattice. Such metallic crystals have very high melting points and they are very, very dense. Another type of crystals are ionic crystals, where the atoms are held together by electrostatic forces. These crystals are hard and they have very high melting points. For example, sodium chloride, potassium chloride, and various other salts. The last but not the least is molecular crystals. These crystals have recognizable molecules within their structures. A molecular crystal is held together by non-covalent interaction like hydrogen bonding, van der Waals forces, pi-pi interactions, etc. These molecular crystals are very soft and they have relatively low melting point. For example, rock candy and the crystalline form of table sugar or sucrose. Various multiple crystalline forms, they can exist in industry. For example, a molecule can bind together to form a polymorph or a co-crystal or solvates of co-crystals, solvates of co-crystals of salts, co-crystals of salts, solvates of salts, plain salts or plain solvates. There are various types of solids which are normally encountered in the chemical industry. Basically, there are two types of distinct types of solids. One is a crystalline solid, wherein the atoms and molecules or ions are bound to each other to form a typical pattern throughout the solid. This pattern consists of two or more molecules which are bound to each other in a particular orientation. The single set of these molecules is called as a unit cell, or it is called as a motif. Crystalline solids comprise of repeating motifs in a particular disciplined orientation. Molecules are bound to each other very strongly by hydrogen bonds, and a unit or a unit cell called as a motif is repeated severally. Another type of solid are called amorphous solids, wherein the molecules are bound to each other but do not form a typical pattern. molecules in an amorphous solid are randomly oriented, meaning these two molecules are bound to each other but very loosely bound compared to the crystalline solids. So there is no typical pattern like it is found in crystalline solids. So this pattern is not repeatable, and hence these molecules are loosely bound. There are seven fundamental types of crystals which are encountered in chemical industry. First one is cubic, wherein the sides are equal and the angles are 90 degrees. Second type is the tetragonal. Third type is the orthorhombic. Fourth type is the monoclinic. Fifth type is the triclinic, then rhombohedral and hexagonal. So let us understand what causes polymorphism in organic solids. As I said earlier, molecules in a solid are bound to each other in various ways depending upon types of functional groups such as proton donor or a proton acceptor group. The intermolecular bond such as hydrogen bond, pi-pi interaction or van der Waals forces, they provide high degree of rigidness to the molecular structure. Intermolecular bond angles and bond length provide specific type of three-dimensional geometry to the crystal lattice. Thus, polymers are formed due to different possible orientation of such rigid structures because the bond angles and bond lengths may be different due to rotatable bonds. This concept we have already studied in the past. What are various proton donor and proton acceptor groups in molecules? Certain examples of proton donors are an amine, a primary amine, an acid, organic acid, or an alcohol. Various proton acceptors are an ether, or a ketone, or a halide, or an ester, or a group where nitrogen has a double bond on one side and a single bond on another side, called as imine. This can be a group which is a pyridine group which acts as a proton acceptor. Let us understand how the polymorph are actually formed, the mechanism of polymorph formation by way of certain example. Let us consider the case of this product called as 3-carbamino-aminobenzoic acid. This is the structure. This is the benzene ring. One side it is COOH, and on the meta part there is this carbamoyl amino group. So what happens is this molecule, another molecule comes near to each other and a hydrogen bond is formed between these two molecules. Such hydrogen bond repeats itself and forms a linear structure in a crystal, and this is called as form 1. Similarly, in another structure, two molecules, they come together in a different orientation other than this. They form hydrogen bonds, but now another molecule comes from the other side, forms a hydrogen bond, and this repeats. So now you can see the difference. This is a plane, this is a zigzag, called as form 2. Obviously, the properties of form 1 and form 2 are different. Let us consider the classic case of paracetamol, which we had discussed earlier. This is the paracetamol structure. Two molecules, they come together, bound by hydrogen. another molecule comes, hydrogen bonding again, another molecule comes, hydrogen bonding again, and this repeats. So this form is called as monoclinic form, and the three-dimensional structure also looks like this zigzag pattern. Same molecule, it can come together and form hydrogen bond in a linear fashion. And this repeats itself and forms another form called as orthorhombic form too. And the actual three-dimensional structure, as you can see, it appears linear. Another case is of ritonavir, which we had discussed in the first slide itself. This is the structure of ritonavir, and if you can observe, there is an amide group over here. This molecule comes near to another molecule and such type of hydrogen bonds are formed, and this molecule, another molecule comes and similar hydrogen bonds are formed. This form is called as form 1. In another form, the same molecule, it reorients in an opposite fashion. See, these groups are present in one side in form 1, whereas these groups are present on the opposite side. So this molecule reverts and comes near to this molecule, and such hydrogen bonds are formed. And same thing repeats. This group is exactly opposite to this group, and it forms hydrogen bonds on this side. And this is called as form 2. As you can see now, due to various orientations of the molecules in the crystal structure, due to different ways the hydrogen bonds are formed, the polymers are formed in a different way. So for example, form 1 and form 2, they have different significant properties. For example, melting point of form 1 and form 2 are different. When a crystalline solid is heated, all the molecules start vibrating briskly about the intermolecular bonds. So this bond is broken at a particular temperature, and it is called as a melting point or fusion point of the solid. As we have already discussed, polymers have different ways of interconnecting intermolecular bonds, and that's why they have different melting points. So form 1 and form 2, they have different melting points. Molecules in amorphous solids are not oriented in a particular manner, because we have already discussed that they are randomly oriented. So therefore, we do not see a sharp melting point in an amorphous solid. Another significant property of solid or polymer is heat of fusion. A crystalline solid has a sharp melting point because all intermolecular bonds, they break simultaneously. When the crystal melts, it absorbs a definite amount of energy. This energy is called as heat of fusion, which is greatly affected by the defects in crystalline structure and presence of residual solvents or impurities in the product. Different polymers have different heat of fusion, and that heat of fusion is a particular fundamental characteristic of that polymer. Now, since amorphous solids are not oriented in a particular manner, the heat of fusion obviously are not constant. So these values may differ from sample to sample, and hence this property cannot be considered to be a characteristic of that solid. One more property of polymer is solubility of solids. When the intermolecular bonding between molecules is broken completely due to solvent, which is called solvation, or due to water, which is called hydration, the molecules, they go away from each other, and the solid is said to dissolve completely into the solvent. Obviously, the amount of solid which goes into such solution, it depends on such forces of attraction between the molecules. Greater the bonding, lesser the solubility. Now, since polymers have different ways of intermolecular forces of attraction, they have different degrees of solubility in solvents. Therefore, it explains why amorphous solids have better solubility, because they are not really bound in a particular way compared to the crystalline counterparts. This leads to another phenomenon called as chemical reactivity. Chemical reactivity of a solid, it depends upon various factors. For example, the solubility or dissociation of the solid in a particular solvent or aqueous reaction medium, thermodynamic properties such as excitation energy and Gripsky energy, and physical orientation of participating functional groups and their proximity to the participating groups of the reagent. For example, if a molecule is having an OH group in the outer part of the crystal, then it can easily react compared to when the OH group is oriented inside the crystal structure. So different polymers have different reactivities. Since their solubility is different and the orientation of molecules in a unit cell is different, as I explained earlier. Amorphous solids are more reactive compared to the crystalline counterparts because, again, like I said earlier, the amorphous solids, they don't have a particular orientation, and therefore the amorphous solids are also more prone for chemical instability. Now let us discuss which are the various methods to determine and measure polymorphism. Polymorphs have different morphologies in their solid state. They have differences in physicochemical properties, and these properties are used in determining and measuring the polymorphism. Various examples of such solid state analytical methods are high resolution solid state NMR, differential scanning calorimetry or thermogravimetry, solid state FTIR, solid state UV visible, Raman spectroscopy, powder X-ray crystallography, single crystal X-ray crystallography, compound microscopy, and thermomicroscopy. Now let us describe one by one various analytical methods and techniques which are used to measure polymorphism, starting with high resolution solid state NMR. This is how the instrument looks like. This is the core magnet, and this is where the sample goes in. When we measure various polymorphs using the solid state technique, we find various differences. For example, this is the high resolution solid state NMR of three polymorphs, form 1, form 2, and form 3, wherein you can see the differences in the signals over here and here. So, solid state NMR will definitely reveal the differences in the form of various signals appearing at various ppm. Another analytical method for measuring polymorphism is differential scanning calorimetry. This is a calorimeter, and this is its diagram, wherein the sample is kept over here and the reference is over here. There is a heating element, and both the samples are both the pans are heated simultaneously, and the difference in the heat absorbed is calculated. This is how the differential scanning calorimetry thermogram of two different polymorphs look like. For example, form 1, it shows an endotherm at 142, whereas in form 2, it shows an endotherm at 144 degrees centigrade. So DSC also is another technique which can be used for measuring polymorphism. Another analytical technique is solid state FTIR, which can be operated in two modes. One is the diffuse reflectance mode, and second one is attenuated total reflectance. This is the instrument, and this is the schematic of the instrument. When polymorphs are subjected to analysis by FTIR, this is how the polymorphs look. Form 1 and form 2. I have taken examples of these two polymorphs. You can note down, in the region of 3000 centimeter inverse, and in the region of 1600 centimeter inverse, you can see marked difference here and here. Next technique is Raman spectroscopy. This is how the instrument looks. The sample is kept over here. This is a solid sample. A laser is passed through a cylindrical lens, and the dichroic mirror, it reflects into a lens, and the spectrum is recorded over here. The Raman spectrum of two different polymers, it looks like that. I have considered the example of form A and form B of a product. I am sorry, I cannot reveal the name of the product due to confidentiality issues, but point to be noted over here is the Raman spectrum is entirely different. For example, you can see this and this, these are different. These are the same products but are different polymers. Notable differences can be seen in this signal also and in this signal also. One more technique used for measuring polymorphism is the powder X-ray crystallography or diffractometry. In short, it is called as PXRD. In fact, PXRD is the basic fundamental technique which is used for determining different types of polymers. PXRD is a technique wherein the sample is kept in a sample cell. This is the X-ray generator and this is the detector. So X-rays are passed on from here. They come and get diffracted from this sample, and the X-rays are collected and the diffractogram is produced. Different polymers have different diffractograms. You can see I have shown here powder X-ray diffractogram of 9 different polymers of a product. You can see polymer 1, 2, 3 and up to 9. These are the angles, 2 theta so called, and this is the intensity count. You can see various differences in the diffractograms. So when somebody manufactures form 1, the diffractogram should look like this. Somebody manufactures form 4, the diffractogram should look like this. And somebody manufactures form 9, the diffractogram should look like this. Here I am not commenting which polymorph is stable or which is not stable, but as an analytical tool, this is the most widely used tool, the powder X-ray diffractometry, to determine various polymorphs. One more analytical technique is the single crystal X-ray crystallography or diffractometry. In short, it is called as CXRD. This instrument is a very, very sensitive equipment wherein the sample is held on to a small needle. You can see over here. And the sample size may be around 1 mm or 0.5 mm. It is a single crystal which is supposed to be very pure. The single crystal is subjected to bombardment of X-rays from here, and this holder is rotated and the detector, it detects various X-rays which are diffracted from the single crystal to give a diffractogram. The single crystal X-ray, it reveals the three-dimensional conformation of the polymorph. I have shown here this molecule of which the single crystal studies have been done, and you can see there are 9 polymorphs and 12 conformers. All these bonds, they are rotatable bonds. So if you imagine in 3 dimension, if the molecule rotates about this bond, the entire group, it will shift over here. Similarly, if the molecule is rotated across this bond, again it will shift to a different extent, so on and so forth. Similarly, this bond is also rotatable. Therefore, in one of the polymorphs, this group will be shifted like this, or when this bond is rotated, this group will go somewhere below. In single crystal X-ray, all these 9 polymorphs have been studied, and the conformation of each of these molecules in the unit cell have been depicted over here. The computer, what it does, it aligns one of the groups. For example, this group, it aligns for all the 9 polymorphs, and it spreads all the molecules, how they spread, like this, in the different polymorphs. So single crystal X-ray will reveal what is the 3-dimensional conformation of this molecule when it is packed in the unit cell using the single crystal X-ray diffractometry. I'm sure we are all clear on how SCRD is a very, very important tool in measuring polymorphism. SCRD also gives the electrostatic surface potential of the molecule. For example, one molecule which has been studied using SCRD has revealed the various electrostatic potentials of various atoms present in the molecule. Now somebody would ask where this is useful. This data is useful in calculating the reactivity of a group. Secondly, the conformation of a particular polymorph, how it varies with the electrostatic potential. Thereby, this data, when it is fed to the computer will be able to tell which polymorph will be more physically stable, which polymorph will be thermodynamically stable, and which polymorph will be kinetically stable. Not just that, it will also give some information about the reactivity of these groups in the solid form. If you remember, I had said in the past that the reactivity of different polymorphs are different, and this data will be useful to tell which polymorph is more reactive, which polymorph is less reactive, which polymorph has higher solubility, or which polymorph has lower solubility in water. So that when we say about solubility and reactivity, it all links to the bioefficacy of that particular polymorph. Therefore, single crystal X-ray will be revealing so many properties like bond angle, bond length, electrostatic potential, various type of conformations, and the reactivity of each group, and indirectly the solubility and bioefficacy of a particular polymorph. The next technique, which is a technique which many people they know, it is called as compound polarizing microscopy. This is a microscope. It is a polarizing microscope, meaning the light which is incident on the cover on the slide It is a polarized light. So in this polarizing microscope technique, various polymers, when analyzed, they look in this way. For example, I have shown here two different polymers, form 1 and form 2, which are observed at different temperatures. If you observe very carefully, in form 1, it appears like this at 25 degrees, at 100 degrees, at 150 degrees, at 211 degrees, 230 degrees, and 217 degrees. If you observe very carefully, the product has completely melted at 217 degrees. So form 1 melting point, you can say, is 217 degrees. If you observe very closely from here to here, see this one. This crystal has just started melting at 213 degrees. In case of form 2, if you observe very closely, the shapes are different than form 1. Nevertheless, at 100 degrees, the shapes are again different. At 150 degrees, at 202 degrees, at 205 degrees, and the compound has melted, the polymer form 2 has melted completely at 211 degrees. Here also you can see a small transition in the shape from 202 to 205 to 211 in form 2. So this technique, it will reveal two things. Number one, how does the crystal shape change with temperature? At what temperature there is a minute change just before the melting, here and here? And what are the actual shapes at room temperature? This information is useful for process chemists to determine the softening point of a particular polymer. One more technique, that is thermomicroscopy. Thermomicroscopy is something similar to the earlier technique, compound microscopy, except that thermomicroscopy has a stage. This is the stage wherein you can load the sample, the powder sample. You put it over here, and the temperature of this stage can be varied as per our requirement. It can go from minus 190 to plus 400. This is the cryo bath wherein we put liquid nitrogen, and liquid nitrogen is circulated in this stage wherein the sample is chilled up to minus 190 degrees, and there is a microscope over here which will observe the sample, and how the shape and the crystal changes when we heat this sample from minus 190 to say 400 degrees, how it changes. This is how the technique works. Let us see into the next slide how the thermomicroscopy image of amorphous and crystalline polymorph looks. Again, I cannot reveal the name of the product for confidentiality issues. So we have considered a product which can exist in amorphous form and a polymorph 2 form. I did not call this as polymorph 1 because it was amorphous. I could have called that polymorph 1, but I was labeling it as amorphous. And we know what is the difference between an amorphous and a crystalline polymorph. So in thermomicroscopy, what we do is we take images of samples which are uncovered. Uncovered meaning, we don't put a cover slip on the slide because we don't want to break the crystalline structure. Because if we put a cover slip, then the crystal will break. Then this crystal is heated and various images are taken. Now, when various images are being taken, we can also add a Raman instrument, Raman detector, which can also give information on how the various Raman peaks are forming or disappearing. In amorphous, this is how the image looks like, whereas in polymorph 2, this is how the image looks like. So you can see a marked difference, and you can also see the shift in the Raman signals. There is a Raman signal over here in amorphous, whereas there is a Raman signal over here in polymorph 2. So after having looked at various techniques which are used for measuring the polymorphs, let us now consider how what are the various applications of polymorphism used in the chemical industry or pharma industry. As you can see over here, I have listed down in a tabular form various pharma products, number of known polymorphs, which are the polymorphs which are bioavailable or in the active form, and what are the various advantages of the polymorphs. Let us have a look at first pharma product, which is called corticosone acetate. There are five polymorphs which are reported, out of which only one form is stable. The remaining forms, form number 2, 3, 4 and 5, they are not stable. Obviously, this is the only form which can be formulated and marketed. Similarly, in case of, say for example, chlorotetracycline, there are two polymorphs which are reported, out of which only one form, called as the beta form, is bioactive. And what are the advantages of this beta form is that it absorbs very fast in the gastrointestinal tract. Thus, beta form of chlorotetracycline is the one which is more advantageous. One more example I can say of phenobarbital. It is having six polymorphs which are known, out of which form number 1, 2, 4 and 6 are having more stability. It means that form number 3 and 5, they are not stable. But out of these, which is most stable, it is yet to be determined. Nevertheless, people who are manufacturing this product, they are manufacturing either form 1 or 2 or 4 or 6 only, and all these forms are patented. Which one is more stable? Which one is more efficacious? I mean, more than the other. And which one is less stable? All these things have been already studied using various other techniques which have been discussed in the past. Phenobarbital. There are six polymorphs discovered until today, out of which form number A, B and F have more stability. Furosemide. There are two polymorphs, out of which polymorph number 1 has photochemical stability. Similarly, for example, in enalapril maleate, there are two polymorphs known until date, out of which polymorph number 2 is thermochemically stable. chloramphenicol palmitate. There are three polymers reported, out of which polymorph number 2 is thermodynamically stable and has a better bioavailability. Efavirenz, it has 6 polymorphs, out of which only one polymorph is more thermodynamically stable. So obviously the rest remaining 5 are useless. Barbital. In barbital, there are 6 polymorphs reported, out of which only polymorph number 3 is active. It is metastable, high kinetic stability, and commercially available. Now, after considering various applications and examples from pharma industry, let us consider some applications of polymorphism in agrochemical industry. These are few products which have been listed by me, few agro products, number of polymorphs, again in the same manner, the active form and various advantages. If I consider the example of fipronil, which is a patented product, 5 polymorphs have been discovered till date. The active form are 1, 4 and 5, out of which the most active form is form 5. In a product called as imamectin benzoate, it was discovered by Japanese. There are 5 polymorphs reported until date, out of which only form 5 is more active and it is easily soluble. It is easily soluble, therefore it is more active. Since it is easily soluble, a formulation of imamectin benzoate in water can be easily prepared. So this formulation also is a patented formulation by the Japanese. In case of a product called flumioxazin, there are as many as 7 different polymorphs, out of which only form 2 and form 7 were relatively stable and more active. Flumioxazin, since it has 7 polymorphs, the remaining forms, form 1, 3, 4, 5 and 6, although they are patented, they cannot be used in formulations because none of them are stable. Now let us consider application of polymorphism in a specialty product. This product probably many of you do not know, and this is a very very special product. This product is called as cyclotetramethylene tetranitramine. In short, it is called HMX. This product is used in explosives. So this is a highly confidential product, but the use and the formulation are all patented. This product cannot be easily prepared in the laboratory, and only restricted laboratories such as ARDE or ERDL in Pune, they are working on this product. This being a very highly sensitive and explosive product, I will resist anyone from working on this product. Nevertheless, this product has been studied very well, and 4 polymorphs have been discovered in this product. Polymorph alpha, beta, gamma and delta. Out of which delta is the least stable, whereas beta is the most stable. So this form is the most stable, whereas this form is the least stable. Finally, I would like to quote a very interesting quote by one of the pioneers called Walter Markron. What he says: every compound, every single compound in the world has different polymorphic forms, and in general, the number of forms known for a given compound is proportional to the time and money spent in research on that compound. In short, any organic compound or any pharmaceutical compound or any agrochemical compound, it can have different polymorphic forms. And in order to know which compound is stable or active, you need to have time and money to be spent in research of that compound. Many thanks for your attention, and if you have any questions, you can contact me on my email or on my WhatsApp, which have been shared with the organizers. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Ajay Chhatre sir, for your nice presentation. Besides your busy schedules, you accept our invitation and accordingly cooperated us. I am sure that the participant of webinar enjoy. I like in your presentation the basic of polymorphism, characterization technique and the applications. Please be in contact with our participant to solve their queries. Thank you very much. That's the end of today's session. Now, I request all the participants, please be in time for tomorrow's session. Take care. See you tomorrow.